How's it going? Welcome back. How was spring break? It's awesome. You missed it. Good song. It's a classic. Coming to class on time, the benefits. All right. So today we're going to finish up the unit on VM. Do I sound funny? I feel like I sound like I've... Sometimes, does this happen to Carl while I was gone? Sometimes Carl's voice like goes up an octave and he sounds like he's been sucking helium and this like lasts for several days. And it's just, it's hard to listen to him without giggling a little bit. So I feel like I sound like that today. So don't laugh. So today we're gonna talk about sort of the last piece of the puzzle. So we proceeded in a similar manner when we approached memory as we did when we approached the CPU. And now we're at the point where we can actually talk about some of the policies that govern how memory is used. And specifically, the particular policy, and there's lots of memory-related policies the operating system is responsible for, but the particular one we're gonna talk about today is how do we decide what pages should be moved out to disk? So how do we make choices about what should be memory resident? Okay, so a couple of notes about the midterm. So in the past, we had this preterm exam at the beginning of class, and that kind of beginning of the term, and that sort of gave us a chance to practice how we do the midterm. So, and that's important because the midterm is a 50-minute exam. It's in this room, which is a bad room to hold an exam in. Other words come to mind, but particularly for a class this large, so there'll be more people here on Friday. There will be people that you haven't seen all semester, that I haven't seen all semester. Like, who are you? And it's important that we do this right? So we have this down, you know, like my crew has been doing this for years, so I think we're pretty good at it, but the variable here this year is you guys. You guys haven't done this before. Okay, so here's why we do this. A couple hours before the exam, I'll distribute a seating chart. So we're gonna use the numbers on these seats, and I'm pretty sure I went around one year and marked all the desks that were broken. You noticed that there's some left-hand desks, so if you want a left-hand desk, please contact me. And if you don't want a left-hand desk, you won't get a left-hand desk, don't worry. I'm sure there's a few new broken seats because, you know, it's UB, so it's been a few years. So we will assign you a seat. We will distribute that seating chart before class. I'll post it on Discourse. It'll also be posted on the doors outside the room. So objective number one is knowing your seat. And we also have like a seating chart so you so know roughly where the seat is in the room. So before you come in, know where you're seating and know kind of roughly where that is. Like these rows are not very easy to maneuver down. So if you spend a lot of time, and once people start sitting in the seats, one of the beautiful features of these seat numbers is that they're invisible once people sit down. So please try to be here on time. When you come in, enter silently. There will be an exam waiting for you on your desk. And that exam will have your ID photo looking back at you. Right, so there's a great moment of sort of self, you know, identification when you sit down and you realize that your exam is cognizant. It's not going to take itself for you, unfortunately, but it will gaze back at you. Things you need. You need a UB ID card. This sometimes has surprised students. Yes, you in fact need a working UB ID card. If you don't have one, you have tomorrow to visit the ID card office and obtain a UB ID card. This is like sort of a thing, right? So you need that. Writing materials and water, or if you need water, and that's what you should have at your seat. Everything else can go up here in these little hallways along the sides, in the back, somewhere else, right? Coats, backpacks, stuff like that. Smartphones, very important. Any sort of electronic device, you know, it's very instinctive during an exam to have a phone ring in your pocket, reach down and grab it, at which point I see it throw you out of the room in a fairly unceremonious and embarrassing fashion and give you zero on the exam, which is one fewer exam that we have to grade, so that's not a problem for me. And once you find your exam, we'll get everybody seated and you guys get started, right? So maybe you think I'm being a little bit pedantic about this, but the exam that I'm giving tomorrow is a 50-minute exam. People typically write till the end of class. So if you guys waste 10 minutes at the beginning of class figuring out, you know, up from down, then that's just few less time you guys will have on the exam. So please, I'll post these things online, but sort of please make sure you come ready to rock. All right, any questions about this? Pretty basic. Okay. Oh, yeah, sorry. So no makeup exams are gonna be given if you're not here and you're not like in the hospital, you will get a zero. Again, those are really easy exams to grade. And I pretty much already said these things. We'll have videotaping set up. And please be very careful about your devices. Just leave them in your coat. Turn them off, right? So we don't have to listen to your ringtone repeatedly during the exam. Maybe if I hear one, I'll answer it and I don't know, like order pizza for you or something like that. Embarrassing. Okay, questions about the exam. Not about content. We'll come back to content later, but about procedures. Okay, sweet. And last reminder, if you want a left-hand desk, email me tonight because I'm going to print the exams tomorrow. Okay, final thing about assignment 3, just last little bit of administrivia. If you are working alone on assignment 3 and for some reason, we need to know this. So please make sure that you've contacted the course staff already. It doesn't hurt to send us another email and just remind us of that fact. Okay, so let's review a little bit about the material that Carl covered on Monday. So difference between a TOB fault and a page fault. You can remind me what the difference is. Two memory-related faults that can occur. Yeah.
TLB faults when the correlation
doesn't exist. Okay. That's a subset of page faults. Who can complete the set? The TLB fault part is correct. So TLB fault is what it sounds like when the TLB doesn't understand how to translate a page. Yeah. Page is not resident in memory, right? So that page might not exist. It might be the kind of page that operating systems create on demand. There's something called zero pages and things like this. It also might have been moved to disk, might have been swapped out to disk. And obviously how the operating system responds to these two faults is quite different. On MIPS architectures, every page fault is preceded by a TLB fault. This is how MIPS works. We'll come back in a minute a slide that sort of was left over from last class and talk about other types of architectures where this is a little bit different. But on the architecture you guys are developing on for OS 161, there really is no notion of a page fault. A page fault is something that the operating system realized this has happened because it tries to handle a TLB fault and realizes that the page it needs is on disk or hasn't been created yet. Now, hopefully, you know, in the best case, again, if some of the algorithms we're going to talk about later work well, the page is in memory, I can load a translation into the TLB very quickly and get on with life. So the TLB faults are much easier for the operating system to handle. A page fault involves, you know, in the best case, having to allocate a page of memory, which may not take very long, but involves a little bit of work. And in the worst case, involves actually moving things back and forth to the disk, which can get really, really slow. So page faults are something that we try to avoid when possible. Okay, so let's say I want to swap a page from core to disk. What are some of the things I need to do? What's the process of doing this? I have a memory resident page, and I want to move it to disk to create more memory. What are the things I need to do? One of them. Yeah, so I better get it out of the TLB. If I wait to do this, what can happen? Let's say I start copying the contents to disk, but I've forgotten to take the TLB entry out. What can happen? Ashish.
It could be updated while
you're copying. Yeah, remember when it's in the TLB, if there's a process running, that process could be running on another core in parallel with the operating system that's actually doing the swap out. So it's really critical that I get it out of the TLB, not only of the core that I'm running on, but of every other core. So this is something you'll have to do in assignment 3. It's called shoot down, right? I need to notify all the other cores that are running that this translation for this process is no longer valid. Because if there's anybody modifying that memory while I'm doing the copy out, the copy that ends up on disk and the copy that I eventually get rid of in memory are not the same anymore. And the whole idea of moving the page to disk is sort of rendered moot. So I have to get it out of the TLB, copy the contents to disk, update my page table, so I need to update the bookkeeping that the kernel keeps around so I know where to find the page later, because I'm assuming that at some point the process is actually going to get back to using this page, and I need to be able to find the contents. All right, so, and you know, here's my fancy diagram for doing this, right? Okay, great. I don't want to spend too much time on review today, because I assume that Carl did an awesome job. So now swapping in. Now I have a page that's on disk. So what triggers, you know, swapping out, so why would I swap out a page? What's the impetus for doing this?
Process needs more space.
Yeah, I'm trying to create memory. You know, I'm either facing memory pressure, I actually have an urgent need to create memory. Or in a lot of cases, what the operating system will do is be continually trimming pages from processes. So if I see pages that haven't been used for a long time, I don't want to wait until I need memory desperately, because usually when I need memory desperately, I'm trying to do something the user is waiting for. And so at that point, it's too late. So a lot of operating systems try to create and maintain a relatively healthy amount of free memory at all time, at all times, right? The amount of memory I'm using is also something that's shared with the file system buffer cache, and that's something we'll talk about. I don't think we've talked about it yet, but we'll talk about it in a few weeks, right? So there's other things I can do with memory. If I create free memory here, I might be able to use it to make the file system look faster. So that's also good. Why am I swapping in a page? This is a little different. So swapping out is something I can kind of do whenever I want to, just in cases where I think a page isn't useful anymore and I'm trying to create some memory that I might need right now and I might just anticipate needing in the future. Why am I swapping in a page? What's the real only reason to swap in a page? Yeah, the process tried to use it. And so suddenly I'm like, I actually need to make this page resident anymore. Remember, I mean, the process tried to do a load or store from a page that I've sort of sneakily behind its back moved out to disk, create more room. And so now the clock is ticking. And so on some level, swapping pages in is a little bit more of a time pressure operation because the process is waiting for this data. There's certain cases where I can try to anticipate this, and we might talk about this a little bit later in the semester, but in a lot of cases I'm doing this because the page is needed now. So the first thing I have to do is stop this instruction. This instruction that's accessing memory cannot proceed until I've restored the memory address that it's trying to use. Now what do I do? Similar to the swap out process, there's a couple extra steps, but what's the first thing I need to do?
Find a place in the memory and then...
Yeah, I need a page, so that's important. And what might this require? Swapping something out. So this is one of the reasons why I try to keep some spare memory around, right? If I have to swap out a page on the swap in path, it's like things just got real bad. Because not only is this going to require an I/O, but the swap out might require another I/O. So something that was going to be slow anyway just got really slow. So again, this is one of the reasons it's nice to keep a memory buffer around. So now I need to find the page on disk using the page table entries. This is, again, something you guys talked about with Carl before, and it's important that my page table entry data structures allow me to do this quickly. Because, again, I'm on a hot path here. I'm not trying to waste time. There's something waiting for this. Copy the contents back. What else do I need to do? I need to update the page table, right, to make sure that the page table knows it's in memory, and load the translation to the TLB. And only at this point can I restart that instruction. And of course, the magic of all of this is that the process has no idea that this just happened. All the process knows is that it tried to access an instruction. It was just on its merry way, just asking an instruction that, trying to use an instruction that accessed memory that it felt like it had every right in the world to use, and suddenly there's this huge gap in time, right? Because I had to do this. Yeah?
So usually when you swap out, do you only do it when the process requires space, or do you do it in advance?
So again, you can do it either. There's two reasons that you can. So one reason is I need space, right? Either I need space for a process page that's been faulted in, or the buffer cache needs space or something like that. But it's useful to have some extra space around. And so a lot of times what the operating system will be doing is sort of in the background, walking around, looking at processes, and being like, you haven't used that page for a while. I'm going to move that to disk preemptively. Right? What's that? Well, I mean, how you decide is something we'll talk about later, right? But the point is, however I'm making the decision, I try to preemptively move some things out to disk to make sure that I have a little bit of chunk of memory, right? Because, for example, you walk up to the computer and you suddenly start up Photoshop or something like that. That results in a huge amount of instant memory pressure. If I'm using all of the memory on the system, then that also results in a lot of extra I/O. And so it's a tension here. I mean, you bought the memory. You want the system to use all the memory. But to handle these sort of unexpected events, particularly startup, right? Starting big programs can produce an enormous amount of memory pressure all of a sudden, right? And the operating system obviously has really no way of predicting when you're about to do that.
So
yeah.
Usually when there are dormant processes, then idle processes which are not used but are not closed, what happens? It's still in memory?
Part of it, maybe. It depends, right? I mean, eventually, if a process is just sitting around not running, But probably what happens is most of its content's been swapped out, right? I mean, have you guys ever had this experience, particularly like if you've run a really memory intensive computation, maybe you ran like an indexing program or maybe a virus collection or a virus something, and there's a program on your computer you haven't used for a while, and suddenly you go to start it and it's just like really laggy all of a sudden, right? I mean, that's what's happening, right? A lot of the pages that that program uses have been moved out to disk because you haven't used it in a long time. And the other thing you need to experience this is that something else has had to run and something else has used up all the memory on the system. So something else has pushed all those pages out. When you go back to that application or that process or that tab or whatever, it can take a while to bring everything back in, right? All right, okay, and then again, we have the pretty diagrams. Okay, one last thing I want to point out before we move on is there are common architectures in use today, including the x86 and maybe ARM too. I really should know this, but I don't. I can look it up later. That have something that's called a hardware-managed TLB. So this is kind of an interesting design choice. So what we've been talking about up to this point is a software-managed TLB. So on the software-managed TLB, the operating system code is what's responsible for loading entries into the TLB. So when the TLB doesn't know how to translate a particular page, all it does is generate a software exception and force the operating system to manipulate the TLB. On x86, what happens is the TLB actually knows how to walk the page tables that the operating system sets up. So when the TLB doesn't know how to translate an address, the first thing it'll do is it'll look through the page tables that are set up for the running process and try to find a valid translation. If the page is in memory, the TLB will automatically update itself and everything will go on, and the operating system doesn't get involved at all. If the page is on disk, then it generates a page fault and then the operating system has to do some work. Now, obviously, there are some trade-offs here. I mean, one trade-off is the operating system has no control over what entries are in the TLB. It's all up to the TLB itself. So when the TLB evicts things, the operating system doesn't know about it. So the TLB is now setting the policy about what entries remain in the TLB. The other thing that is probably obvious to you is that the operating system and the TLB now have to agree on the format of the page tables. So if the TLB is going to walk the operating system page tables, the TLB has to understand the page table data structures. And so that limits some of the design choices you can make in the operating system about how the page tables work, because the TLB has to understand. This is a piece of hardware, right? It's not something you can reprogram. Yeah?
Could you theoretically write or build a piece of hardware to walk the swap
disk? Yeah. Yeah. You'd have to, you know, the thing with pages that are on the page table, stuff gets more complicated, right? Sometimes it's a copy on write issue. Sometimes you have zero fill pages that you want to create on demand, right? Sometimes you want to share pages between processes. So yeah, but you could. You absolutely could. Yeah. So this is a, you know, again, a design choice that people made. The pro here, obviously, is I avoid a certain number of operating system exceptions. The hardware can do this faster, and avoiding the context switching to the operating system can save time. And the con is some of the things we've already talked about, that the page table data structures are fixed. And it also limits the operating system's visibility into certain types of faults. Yeah, Rajesh.
What changes in the faults?
So that's a good question. So on a hardware-managed TLB, how is the operating system experience different? So before we talked about there's two types of faults. There's TLB faults, and there's page faults. On a software-managed TLB, the only faults that are generated by the TLB are what kind? Or the only faults that are generated by the MMU are what kind of faults? They're TLB faults, right? So essentially, the TLB says, I don't have an entry, and then the operating system might discover when it looks up the entry in the page table that the page is on disk. On a hardware-managed TLB, what are the only kind of faults that are generated? Page faults. Because the TLB faults are handled automatically by hardware. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So I just said that, right? The TLB faults are never handled in hardware. The only faults that the operating system actually sees are page faults. Right? So that's the point where the MMU really throws up its hands and says, I have no idea what to do now. I tried my best. I did this cool thing. And again, I should figure out what ARM does. I have a suspicion that ARM has a hardware-managed TLB as well. Yeah, size of the disk. I mean, normally, yeah, that's not normally true. I mean, normally you don't need a a swap file that's anywhere close to the size of disk. But on Windows, I mean, has anyone done this? I mean, Windows has like a swap file, I think, that you can reconfigure. I can't remember what they call it. What is it called?
If you go to your settings there in the virtual memory section, then you can choose how
many megabytes
you want to
set. Right. And on, has anyone ever set up a Linux machine before? When you set up the partition table, there's an area for swap, right? It's a fixed size. I think on Linux now, usually they suggest like the same amount of memory, right? So that's a reasonable default, but you could set that to be larger. But you don't, like, at some point, usually I don't need, you know, particularly with growing memory sizes, I don't need a huge swap file on disk. Right? Good questions. All right. Any questions about this before we talk about policies? At this point, you guys sort of understand that the core memory management policies, that the, sorry, mechanisms that were.
If I don't consider an operating system to use disk, so can can I run on top of memory?
So you can run out of memory even if you configure it to use disk, right? So that's a great question. Wasn't there a slide on the Linux out of memory killer? That's one of my favorite pieces of software. It's like a total hack, right? So Linux can run out of memory for a variety of reasons. So there are certain pages that the kernel needs that have to remain in memory, right? And then in certain cases, I can run out of swap space. So I have so many pages in memory, I have nowhere to put them in the swap file anymore, particularly on Linux because I have a fixed size swap file. So what do I do then? Let's say the operating system is literally sort of out of memory, right? I've played all these games I can play, and I have no memory left. What do I do? What are some options? I could, like, reboot, you know? That's, like, whatever. I mean, there are no good options at this point. So everything we're going to talk about is, like, a nasty hack, right? Rebooting seems dramatic, right? What else could I do? Yeah. Yeah, I could just start killing processes. Linux doesn't do this randomly. Linux has something called the out-of-memory killer. And it has this, I mean, it might as well be random, right? I mean, it has some sort of weird metric for deciding what process it's going to kill. Some of it makes a little bit of sense, because one of the things it at least considers is how much memory is the process using. There's no point killing off processes that aren't consuming any memory. They're like, hey, I'm not the problem, you know? Look over there, it's like Postgres has like 8 gigs, right? Like, you should talk to Postgres about its memory usage. The code for this is really weird, right? But it's this strange calculation that is done, and then it just shuts down a process, right? And I don't know if you guys have maintained Linux machines, you may have seen this happen before. Particularly when you run things that have memory leaks, and over time they start consuming more and more memory, eventually, you know, that the system runs out of memory, and you get some sort of message that says the out-of-memory killer killed. Usually the most useful thing on your system is, for some reason, the thing that gets killed, right? Like, I shut down the web server. Thanks, right? I didn't want that. Yeah? Yeah, usually once you've hit the end of your swap, something's wrong. Right. I mean, you're usually trying to do too much with the machine, or something has a bug that's causing it to leak memory, and yeah. I mean, reboots sort out a lot of this stuff, right? Particularly when you have slow memory leaks. Yeah. So yeah, once you can definitely get to the point where you're completely out of memory, and at that point, kind of like, you know, sometimes restarting things helps, right? So I think actually what the out-of-memory killer does is it sends like a sighup, so it asks the process to restart. And in certain cases with things that have memory leaks, if I just reboot the web server or restart, you know, whatever background service is consuming a lot of memory, the memory leak goes away. And then I start over, right? And things are good for a while. So yeah, good question. All right. Okay, so let's talk about page replacement policy. So this is something that, when I'm under memory pressure, is pretty important. And so I have this decision to make when I evict pages. So when I need memory, this can be because I urgently need memory to bring in a page that a process actually needs right now, or I can apply the same logic to try to find pages to move out to disk just to create that spare memory that I want to keep around in case the user suddenly launches an application that uses a lot of memory. So here's the cost-benefit calculation when I do swapping. What's the benefit? Swapping out a page. What do I get? What does the operating system get out of moving a page to disk? Yeah. Well, that's what I get from the aggregate, right? But what do I get from just one page? I moved one page to disk. What do I have now? Because I'm going to do some work, right? Yeah. I have 4K more memory. How long do I have that memory? Forever? That would be awesome. I'm creating more memory on the system. Every time I swap out a page, I get 4K more memory forever, right? Like, I just like, I have a great, that's an awesome strategy for memory management. Yeah, exactly. So the cost is, I have to move things to disk. And this is considerable, right? But I mean, this is pretty much fixed. Okay, there's not much I can do about this. People have talked about ways to optimize this, but it doesn't really matter, right? I've got to move stuff to disk. I've got 4K stuff, or 8K, or 2 megabytes, if we're talking about, you know, large pages, whatever. I've got a chunk of bits. Now, who knows what they are? And they've got to go to disk, and they've got to get there. So this is not something I can usually attack. The benefit, however, is a little more interesting. So I have, again, I have some amount of memory. I have a page of memory. How long do I have that memory? Forever is not the correct answer, right? How long do I have it? Till the page gets swapped back in. Okay? So there is where I have a little bit of leverage. Yeah, Ashish.
Not necessarily, right? Like another process can just one page and then just get out there.
Well, I'm conceptually think about this particular page, right? I'm pushing this page out to disk, right? The longer that page stays on disk, the longer I can pretend that I have this 4K of extra memory, right? So as long as the page on disk remains unused, I'm good. You know, so essentially what we try to do here is maximize the benefit. Again, there's things we can try to do to minimize the cost, but it's really hard to get this to go away entirely, right? So another way to think, you know, if I do a good job of maximizing the benefit here, this also accomplishes minimizing the page fault rate, right? Because I'm going to have fewer page faults overall. Thrashing. Now, this is an interesting question. So memory is so cheap today. Does anyone's computer do this anymore? I do feel like a little boy or something. My voice is like in a weird octave. Yeah. That will probably do it, actually. Like, open like 2 VirtualBox instances, each configured to use half of your RAM, right? And then try to do something. I mean, it's sort of, I don't know. I mean, our computers have a lot of memory today, right? So it's not clear that this happens. But has anyone ever experienced this happening? Like, yeah. So, I mean, you know this when this happens. I mean, this is when you really think hard about rebooting, and probably do, right? Because, you know, the machine is really unresponsive. On old machines, again, you guys are so young, you haven't had these experiences. The disk is loud, and it's like, you know, it's making all this noise. The mouse starts, you know, arcing across the screen, like suddenly showing you history about, it's like I turned on mouse history. I didn't want mouse history, I didn't really care. Like, this is a very, very distinct experience. And again, this is what happens when everything just goes terribly wrong, and the system is making, for some reason, making very, very bad decisions about what to move back and forth. But there's no real, you know, there's no real explicit definition of thrashing. It's a sort of colloquial experience, but you do notice. And essentially what's happening, you know, again, think about, we talked about scheduling. There's overhead to making scheduling decisions. That overhead is not doing useful work. Swapping, there's overhead to moving things back and forth. That overhead is not useful work. But when I get stuck doing so much of it that I can't get anything else done, it's very, very noticeable. Particularly because I/O is so slow, right? I like this. This causes the performance of the computer to degrade or collapse. Okay. So how do we maximize this benefit? What's the goal here, right? So again, cost I can't really do much about. How do I maximize the benefit of the swap out decision? Yeah. So okay, so that's a good thing to do preemptively, right? I can definitely make sure that I don't get into the thrashing situation by doing this, right? But when I'm actually picking a page, whether it's before I start thrashing or when I need memory, how do I maximize the benefit? Yeah.
You're gonna pick a page that you're not gonna use for a while.
Pick the page that's gonna stay on disk the longest, right? The best, there is an amazing choice here, right? Maybe this is sort of like Dan's optimal solution, right? There are pages that are like the magic unicorn here, that if I can find them, everything is great. What page is that? What page is going to stay on just the longest? How long is a page going to stay on? What's the longest a page could stay on disk? Like the end of time, right? It will never be used again. So again, you blundered into some strange menu in Word, and like it was really, you know, you were really terrified, so you ran away and like went back to using the five commands you know how to use. And that code will never come back into memory, ever. You know, you've learned your lesson. Like you're not going into that submenu again. So, so those pages, you know, again, can be moved to disk, and they will never come back. So that's the ideal. Most pages aren't like this. Unfortunately, it's too bad. I mean, some are. But you know, so now let's go back and you know, what do we do when we think about scheduling algorithms? What if we had? What's the Oracle solution? So if there's an Oracle solution, the Oracle solution is going to know how long it is before a page gets used. So if there's something about the future here that this algorithm wants to know, it's simply how long before this page gets brought back in. If I knew that, I order pages by that, and I pick the one with the maximum. Done. Like that is the provably optimal solution to minimizing the page fault rate. So yeah. Anyway, obviously this is easy. Okay. Unfortunately, this is a hard scheduler to actually implement, right? Because I don't have this information about the future. So what do we do when we can't predict the future? Use the past to predict the future. So now we're going to start talking about how we actually try to implement this and get this to work. So let's say that I want to start. So clearly, I need to know something about how pages are used, and that's actually one of the big trade-offs when designing page replacement algorithms that we didn't have when we designed schedulers. Why is this such a problem? So schedulers can actually track a fair amount of state about each process on the system. What makes this hard to do for pages? Let's say I wanted to track every time a page is accessed, you know, if pages are, you know, like how many times a page has been accessed, you know, rolling averages of how long it's been, things like that. Why is this so difficult? So there's two problems. That's one of them. So one of them is there's so many pages. There's not that many processes on the system. There might be a few thousand processes on the system. There could be billions of pages on the system. And so I have to think a lot more carefully. Remember, we spent a lot of time designing these page table data structures to be really compact. We were really proud because we got all the information we needed to store a page into like 32 bits. And now you're telling me I'm going to store a 32-bit timestamp with every page? You've just doubled the size of my page table entries. Probably not ideal. The other problem is actually also visibility. So think about a hardware-managed TLB. What information does that hardware-managed TLB actually not share with me? So remember, hardware-managed TLB is going to be walking the page tables behind my back and loading the TLB. So what does the operating system not see anymore? Yeah, unless the hardware decides to share that information with me, which maybe it does. Maybe the hardware keeps in statistics that I can use. But in order for the operating system to track this information, I actually have to get involved. So when scheduling, again, I mean, the operating system knows exactly how long things run because it's in control. But with memory, I have these hardware assists. I have these pieces of hardware that are helping me out, and they can get in the way by sort of obstructing the operating system's visibility into things that are going on. So in a lot of cases, operating systems actually don't have detailed information about how often each page is tracked, or each page is used, or what kind of use, right? I might know that the page was used over some period of time. I don't know how many times. It could have been one time or a million times. I don't know what type of use that was. It could have been read-only or a mixture of reads and writes. This information is just not considered that, you know, useful enough for the hardware to store. And it also makes the process of translating pages slower. Yeah?
Is it a good idea to categorize pages depending on the processing? Or the types of processes and then set the categories?
Types of processes. How would I do that?
If, let's say, you use Photoshop.
Yeah.
Then the priority for that, those pages used by Photoshop changes depending on the
So it's not something we're going to talk about today, but a lot of operating systems have a concept of what's called I think we talked about this in the past. We talked about locality, a working set for a process. Here's another way to think about what, and this goes back to this idea of trying to trim all the time. So imagine the operating system. It knows that the process needs a certain number of pages to make forward progress smoothly, but it may not know exactly what pages those are or how many. So one approach is I can trim, and I can keep trimming, and if the page fault rate of the process suddenly starts to go up, then, or I can reduce the total number of pages that are allocated to that process. And at some point, the total number of the page fault rate's gonna increase. And at that point, I stop. I sort of back off, right? So I try to give the process as few pages as possible while also maintaining a reasonable page fault, right? That allows a process like Photoshop, which naturally needs a lot more memory, to have a lot more memory, right? I certainly don't want to say, okay, Bash and Photoshop both get the same memory allocation, right? That results in completely unnecessary allocations to Bash and terrible performance for Photoshop, right? So there's actually a lot of subtlety here, right? I mean, this one lecture is glossing over like 30 or 40 years of thought and design. Which to some degree has all been rendered moot because now you just buy like 32 gigabytes of RAM and call it a day, right? Yeah. What's that? Sorry?
So if I prioritize two different processes, if I have a process with three that I prioritize and one with no priority, would that be something more secondary or?
I suspect that is considering. Yeah, absolutely. I certainly don't want to essentially, because the access to memory affects the priority of the process, right? It affects my ability to run. So if I have a really high priority process, but I've taken all of its memory and moved it to disk, it can't run very, very much, because every time it runs a few instructions and then it faults, and I have to wait for things to come back into disk. So yeah, absolutely. So these are the challenges when I start thinking about storing this information, right? How do I store this compactly? How do I figure out how to get the hardware to give me the information I need? And then how do I, how do I store it as part of the page table entries? Yeah, so we've talked about this, right? So, you know, the statistics can be expensive to collect. And here's another, one of these classic trade-offs. We talked about scheduling algorithms, but the scheduling algorithm takes so long to run that it wastes so much time that I could have used to actually do useful work. It's not very helpful. Similarly, if the information that I'm trying to store to make quote unquote better page replacement decisions consumes so much memory that it would have been better just to like use that memory for useful stuff. Remember, this is overhead. The kernel page table data structures are not useful memory. Nobody gets to store cat pictures in them or whatever, right? They're just wasted. And so the more memory I use for this, this is not good. All right, so simplest possible page replacement algorithm. This sort of goes back to our scheduling discussion about schedulers. What was the simplest possible schedule?
Random,
yes, great. You've at least we've appreciated, gained an appreciation for randomness, right? No state, no queues, no whatever. Just pick a page at random and throw it out. And again, this is not a bad starting point. When you guys are implementing assignment 3, I would suggest that you use random, right? It's very easy to do. And as usual, it's a good benchmark for building other things. Random simple, it is probably too simple. When I choose, so what's the worst case scenario here? Like for choosing, what can happen if I choose the worst page to swap out?
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Like no sooner did I swap it out that it heads right back in. Right? In fact, the most depressing thing that can happen on a multi-core system is while I'm actually swapping it out, the process runs on another core and needs that memory, right? So like I know like halfway through doing this long task that I'm and a lot of times there's no way to, I mean, at least on OS 161, there's no good way to cancel the I/O, so it's like, no, it's terrible. Anyway. Yeah, that's the worst case, right? I mean, imagine you're in the middle of doing some stupid, tedious task, and someone tells you that it's worthless, and you have to undo all of it, right? But you have to finish it first, right? Yeah, anyway, so that's bad. That's what we try to avoid, and from time to time, random is going to pick that page, right? And you're going to feel bad about it. actually, I guess the nice thing about choosing random for assignment three is it forces you to handle that terrible corner case, which is great, because that's one of the nastier little pieces of assignment three, is figuring out how to get this right. Okay, so an algorithm that tries to predict the past, so in general, the common approach to doing this that doesn't get into all these complexities of working sets and other things is just this idea that once a process has stopped using a page for a while, it's probably done using that page. So this is this idea of least recently use. Find the page that the process hasn't touched for the longest and move that page out to disk. And again, I'm using the recent past here to predict the future. The recent past is the process hasn't used the page. The prediction for the future is it won't use it again. Yeah.
Well, at a certain point,
so ideally,
start.
Yeah, so this is a great question. So ideally, if I could store lots of state about the page, I could store the timestamps that the process used the page. And then I essentially say, what's the page that is resident for this process that has not been touched for the longest? Right? Does that make sense?
Yeah, well, I mean, I'm just saying, so like the process starts swapping in pages.
Right. Well, remember, I'm doing this when I need pages, right? Like, not. Wait, I'm still confused by your question. So, if I've touched a page, okay, I see what you mean. Yeah, I mean, if I'm trying to force a process to use like two pages, then things are going to be bad, right? That's possible. You can get that to work. In fact, I remember one year when we were testing Harvard assignment three kernels. Hopefully, this will make you guys feel better about your submissions. We had one submission that never failed, but ran like seemingly endlessly, right? Like, I think David was testing this one, and he could not get it to finish, right? He let it run for several days. It finally got killed off by like one of the system administrators that I think thought it was a virus or something. So he moved it to his private machine, and he let it run for a week or something, running parallel VM, and it finished, actually. Like, it never stopped. I think we concluded they had accidentally like forced the process to use like only two or three pages, right? So it was essentially running with like 14K of RAM, right? Which was slow. but it was awesome. It just ran and ran and ran. And David was like, well, I think we should keep giving it a chance. I was like, at some point we have to turn in grades. It finally finished once we found it a happy home where it could work like one of the most futile tasks ever. Right? I mean, parallel VM is pretty stupid anyway, right? And running it with three pages is even dumber. So anyway, I mean, if you're really over-constraining the process to the point, then yeah, there really are no good decisions, right? Once you get out of the working set, right, then you start to think about this, right? All right, so this was what we'd like to do. This is LRU, this is the goal. This might be as good as we can do without being able to predict the future. The cons here come down to storing the state, right? So how do we tell how long it's been since a page was accessed? And how do we store how long it's been since a page is accessed? And again, if this ends up doubling the size of my page table entries, and therefore doubling the size of my page table related data structures, this is probably not good. Plus, in a lot of cases, remember, I can't even tell when the page has been accessed, or not very accurately. All right, so if we're loading entries into the TLB, we know this. Now here's the other thing about even on a software managed TLB. So even when the operating system is being asked to load entries into the TLB, do we know when the page was accessed? Why not? I mean, I know a time when the page was accessed, right? So what's a time that a page was accessed? When I loaded it into the TLB. So I know for a fact, right, that, you know, it was accessed at this point because I put it in the TLB. But at that point, what do I know? Nothing. Like, absolutely nothing. So for example, I could have two TLB faults, one for a page that gets used once, one for a page that gets used continuously by the process over the next, you know, 10 seconds. From the operating system's point of view, both of them were used at the same point. and distinguishing between them is very difficult. Remember, part of the goal of the TLB is to have enough entries so that once the process starts to run, I have to fill it up, but then at some point, it just runs away. And I don't have to add entries as often. And so I lose visibility at that point for what's going on in the TLB. I was actually talking with a colleague of mine at Duke recently, and he was, they're doing some work on taint tracking on Android, and I guess on newer systems, one of their approaches was basically as slow as forcing the kernel to get involved with every load and store, right? So we talked about how slow that was in class, and I was like, how slow is it? He's like, I lost track of how many zeros like we had to add. It was like 100,000 times slower than the regular system. So we can't do this on a normal machine. So I don't have visibility into this. And recording every page access is way too slow. Again, that would be equivalent to not having a TLB at all, right? All right, am I out of time? Okay, I have time to talk about the clock. We're gonna finish the clock. Again, you can sort of do the math on storing this information, right? So if I have 32 bits, that doubles the page table size. Maybe I can store 8 bits of time, but I really only have 256 ticks. What's a tick? I have to decide in the kernel. Maybe that's a second. Maybe it's a microsecond. So this gets tricky. You know, just the idea of sort of trying to cram time into these data structures. So measuring it was bad enough. So now, actually, how do I find the least recently used page? The page table data structure that I've created is not built for this. It's built for quickly taking a virtual address and finding a page table entry that has more information about the page. It is not built as like a heap to allow me to quickly find the smallest entry. And so this would have to be another data structure that I have to layer on top of this, right? Which sounds pretty bad. Sort of a classic algorithm for doing this that maintains some of the properties that we want from least recently used, but is way simpler to implement, is something called the clock. It is simple, it requires one bit of information, and it achieves LRU-like properties. All right, so here's what we do. When we need a page to evict, we go through all the pages that are in memory in some order. And when you guys start implementing assignment 3, if you guys have started and you're working on your core map, you can think of a logical way to do this, right? So I go through pages in order, pages that are in memory, pages that I can evict, pages that aren't pinned for some reason. And if the page has been accessed, if the page has the accessed bit set, I clear it and move on. If the page's access bit is clear, then I evict it. Sorry, I said those backwards, right? So if the page access bit is clear, I evict that page and stop. If the page access bit is set, I clear the bit. And there's one last thing here, which is that when pages are accessed, specifically when I load them into the TLB, I set this bit. Does that make sense? So when I load the TLB or when I know the page was accessed, I set this bit in this data structure. When I need a page, I go through them in order, clearing bits until I find one that's clear, and then I evict that page. Yeah?
But you only evict one page, or does it clean
out? No, I'm looking for one page. I mean, I could be looking for n pages, right? But the algorithm's the same. I'm looking for one page, I go till I find one clear bit, kick that out. If I need more pages, I start at the same point, right, and keep going, right? If I always started at the beginning, that would be very unfair to the pages that were beginning in memory. Yeah. Whenever I know that the page was accessed, in this case, you can think of it as loading the TLB. That's the visibility you have on the system you're working on. So here's the obligatory diagram. Let's see that these are the pages that start out with their access bit clear. I remove that page. Next time I keep going, I'm clearing bits as I go. So again, in parallel, what happens is as those pages are used, those bits are being set again. And so pages that are being used frequently essentially constantly have their bits being set. And so every time the clock hand comes back to them, they're still set, and they don't get evicted. A page that has not been used long enough for the clock to clear the bit and then make an entire traversal of the rest of memory and come back to it gets evicted. So again, so this ends up having LRU-like properties while only consuming one bit of data, right? It is not perfect LRU by any means, but it consumes a lot less information. So if just from a high level, what does it mean when we're almost done? What does it mean when the clock hand is turning slowly? What does that mean about the system? Well, it also can mean I don't have a lot of memory pressure, right? I mean, this is the ideal case, right? Pretty quickly, I find a page to evict, and I'm not needing pages very often. If the clock hand starts, or we're making good decisions. If the clock hand starts moving really quickly, so the worst case scenario for clock is that I start, and all the bits are set. And so what happens if all the bits in memory are set? What's the algorithm going to do? It always has to find a page. So it's going to go all the way around, clearing bits until it gets back where it started, where it will find a clear bit. So in that case, usually what's happening is there's lots of memory pressure, or for whatever reasons, the clock LRU algorithm is evicting bad pages. Right? This is the bad case. Essentially, at this point, it almost becomes random. I'm basically evicting whatever page the clock starts with. Okay, questions about this? Before we wrap up? Yeah.
So
you guys can start packing up.
We waste a lot of resources like keeping track of the page that was last used.
It's one bit for clock.
So it's one bit for every page. So
it's one bit for every page in memory. Yeah.
I'm not asking about memory wasting. I'm asking the processor. You use a lot of the processor to keep that.
No, remember, the operating system sets that bit when I load the TLB. The processor has no role in this. Right? Yeah, or whenever the operating system knows the page was used. Right. All right, good luck on the exam on Friday. Oh, we didn't get a copy on it. That's okay. That won't be on the exam.